Okay, good evening, everyone. The mayor is on his way, however, I'm going to start the meeting because of the time constraints for this evening. Could you please help me and stand to salute the flag? I pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. First item on the agenda is hearing of visitors. The hearing of visitors is an opportunity for the public to address the school committee. The school committee listens to the comments and takes the matters under advisement. We do have a shortened meeting this evening. Normally it's 3 minutes. We would ask that you try to be as close to 3 minutes as possible. And if you have already spoken about an issue, could you please, I guess, cover new ground, so to speak, if the school committee has already heard what you had to say and what you were going to say is basically repeating from your last opportunity. So we will start with Amanda Carlson. Amanda. Good evening. How are you, Amanda?
I'm great. How are you?
Good.
Tonight, I'm not going to bend your ear about how this program helps the children, because I had a chance to tour the Barrett last night, and it's a beautiful school, but the painting on the walls and murals do not make a preschool. It felt more like an elementary school to me. It has been brought to my knowledge that the Huntington School does not have a playground. That is not true. The Huntington School does have a playground. That is not city-owned. In 1997, I went to that school and we bought bricks that which line the walkway and have people's names on them, and that money went to that playground. So that playground can be used by the school. I don't know why they do not use it. We will take a huge loss in our outdoor space. We have events like Special Olympics and Fun Day, and we were told last night that for them to do those events, they would be in that open field. Our school has runners. There is no way we can put runners in an open field. That is city owned. So therefore you're opening it up for anyone to walk through that while you're having an event. We also take a loss in our indoor space. We will not have a cafeteria, they said. That will be the multi-purpose room. So our children will eat in the classroom. So they will be stuck in a classroom for 2.5 hours. We have them go to the cafeteria for a reason, for their snack. It helps them learn to form a line, to walk in a line, get their trays, sit down with their peers, and throw their trays away. That helps them transition into kindergarten, where they have to do that into kindergarten. So you're taking that away from them. Last month, we held a spaghetti dinner at the Gilmore School, and we had to fit 135 people in our cafeteria. There is no way me on the PTA would be able to fit 135 people in that cafeteria to raise money for these students to be able to do things like our fun day. And we profited $475 from our spaghetti dinner. That is huge. They have not profited that much in 3 years. And the summer program, what are you guys doing with the summer program? How are you gonna hold the summer program with all this moving around? That feels like it's not okay. And you say the Huntington has no place to do like functions for like an auditorium. When I went there, we walked across the street to Sell Junior High to do our talent shows and our concerts. Why can that still not be done? It wasn't a problem then, it shouldn't be a problem now. And you're saying that the Huntington has only a little area to play in that's grass and fenced in? Well, what about the Downey School? What makes them any different? They have a little patch of grass that's not fenced in at all for recess. So why is the Huntington School special and the Downey School isn't? You're just focusing on one school. That's not okay. And during arrival and dismissal, there is no way to get an emergency vehicle in and out of that school. If there was ever an emergency, there will be no way to get that down that little road where the cars have to park to drop off those children. So you're running into problems there also. We have up to 150 cars that drop off children in the morning and in the afternoon, plus 13 special needs vans. You're not fitting that in there. The dismissal will take way too long to get the cars in and out of. We lose 5 classrooms altogether. Not 2, 5. We have 335 kids in our program now and expected to have 350 next year. How are you going to get them in and out of the school with this, with the dismissal process? And what are you guys doing with the Huntington School Parade? That's a huge tradition in the city. Huge. You're just going to get rid of it? That's not okay. And the Huntington does work. That you guys tried to do this in 2010 and it didn't work. You lost. So why are you taking from the youngest? They're the ones that are suffering the loss. You could take the Barrett School and raise the bathrooms and throw the Goddard in there if you have to. I know you guys don't want to do that, but it sounds like it would be way more less money to do that than it is to spend $157,000. And that's all I have to say to you.
Elizabeth Kahn.
Okay, I spoke last time. I'm gonna do something a little different. I don't know if that sounds normal or not. I had a chance to tour the Barrett Russell School. Sometimes you get a feeling, a vibe. I didn't get a cozy vibe, a comfy vibe. It was almost like, I just don't physically see our children in this building. I got a great tour. The principal was wonderful. Thank you for the tour. But I'm gonna focus more on the therapies part of it. The speech therapy area is so small, I don't see how a child could benefit in such a small space. When my son got evaluated by the wonderful speech therapist at Gilmore, there was big open space, and the OT and the speech collaborated together and was able to work with my child. There was a lot of space to work with. I have no idea how that's going to work in such a small space. The other thing that I had an issue with last night was they had this tiny, tiny, tiny office, and then you go out and there's a desk. What about the privacy? What about if a child, you know, they want to have privacy with the therapist? Then the kids will be running all over the halls. I don't emotionally or physically see this. The other thing is the OT. As I explained before, I'm not going to repeat myself, but with sensory issues and things like that, you need movement, you need a sensory diet, you need a big swing. Where's that swing gonna go? I saw the cafeteria, not very big. That counter takes up a lot of the room. The other thing is, I noticed that the principal had indicated that the doors don't lock from the inside. That's very concerning because a lot of children can't sit still, especially if they have some issues or children in general. So they can walk out and say, see you later. And no one would notice. So I don't feel it's a secure area. I'm upset about where are those wonderful speech therapists going to have that space to work, and the OTs also, especially with the APE. So I'm focusing more on the therapies tonight. Where are these children going to get the best therapy, and where are they going to have their space to do their own thing? Sometimes they go in groups, motor groups, speech groups. My son's in a speech language classroom. Is that going to be taken away? The last point I'll make, full-day pre-K. I said it before. My daughter has an amazing teacher, Miss Bridget. She's here. And she has come miles. And I got the impression last night that that would not even be available with this move. And I think that would be detrimental to the children that need it. I'm done.
Helen Verga.
I think for the sake of time, I will pass. I think the first two speakers did a great job, and I think everybody knows where I stand.
Aracelia? Aracelia Lumbe.
Good evening, everyone. My name's Aracelia, as you just mentioned. I am a mother of three, and all of my three children have gone to the Huntington School. I am here to talk about many changes and how sometimes changes are difficult. And we may see the benefit not when the changes are happening, but I don't want the committee to make a decision and oversee the other children, because I understand parents of special needs children, they are going to advocate for the children, but we all should be advocating for our children. At this point, I want to just share some experiences that I've had, not only with the Huntington School, but with the school system. My oldest child is he's a sophomore here at the high school, and he started at the Keith School. Actually, some of his teachers in preschool are at the Gilmore School right now, which they did do a wonderful job. My two boys were premature babies, 32 and 27 weeks. They were slated to be special needs children, and they were involved with early intervention and all of this. I was lucky enough to see them age out and face out of special needs. One of them had an IEP, but I am thankful that that's all he had involvement with special education. However, the changes that my children have seen throughout the Huntington School are, my older son was the poster child for the school uniforms. He was devastated when this was introduced because to many parents and to many kids, they did not want to deal with the school uniforms. He loved it so much that he actually was the child in the front of the brochure for the Huntington School uniforms to present it to other kids. He's a middle schooler now in eighth grade, he was one of the first children in the group that joined Bridgewater in the Bridge program. This was when all chaos was happening and there was very big concern about college students being involved in the elementary schools. I'm sure you guys are all aware with some of these schools. I don't want to name any organizations, but some of the college kids and bad interactions happening with elementary school children. When this was all going on in the Huntington School, the staff in the Huntington School, the partnerships, the parent involvement, and all of this was done, they reassured us. The staff did reassure us of many things happening well, and my son is now, he started in fourth grade. He is now in the eighth grade and hopefully getting ready to go back and mentor younger children in the same program that he assisted 4 years ago. I don't want you guys to oversee the children that are not in special needs, where we have seen many changes such as sports being cut in the middle schools. I had boys that were devastated because that's their outlet for social interaction. And I now have a high schooler who was crying last year when it was mentioned to him that his baseball coach would probably not be at the high school because of all the school cuts. I know and I understand business is business and we only have a specific budget, but I understand that we have to make ends meet one way or another. As for a very long time, single mom, I had to make ends meet and we have to cut where we need to. I don't want the children that are not physically here, the parents that are not here having their voices heard, not be represented and suffer the consequences for making arrangements for one group of children. I feel that changes are good. Sometimes changes are not very welcome when they're happening. However, once we make adjustments, I am positive that our staff, our professionals, as they had worked with my children 10 and 11 years ago, they are able to also adjust. My children went to the preschool when it was located at the Keith School, what was known at the Keith School in on Warren Avenue. And adjustments were made and things happened. Children absolutely blossomed and they developed with the changes happening with careful consideration. I just want to make sure that you guys also understand the standpoint from all of the other parents and all of the positives that we are seeing with the positive changes, again, and meeting. And I just hope you consider not only the special ed students in the preschool, also the elementary schools, the middle schools, and the high school programs that are so instrumental to our children. Thank you.
And last is Keith Lawson.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak again. As you know, I'm Keith Lawson. My son Nathaniel is a student at the Gilmore School. Been to the last two meetings, and I've raised different concerns each time, one being security, flow of traffic, well-being of my son, the transition and how that'll affect children with autism, and this, that, and every other thing. This time, I have a different question, so to speak. I'm a diesel technician. I work on trucks for a living. And basically, if I do my job incorrectly and an accident occurs on a vehicle that I work on, we could have what's called a critical incident. That means severe injury or somebody could die. That's what I do. That's my job. But in my field, we have two different kinds of fixes. There's the permanent fix, which is when you fix the truck and it can pass all scrutiny from the feds and from the state, DOT inspections, et cetera, and every other thing. Then there's a temporary fix. A temporary fix is when you fix a truck just well enough to get it back to the shop so you can do a permanent repair on it. This proposal, because I always hear the phrase, growing the program, I've heard this several times. Is this a permanent fix or is this a temporary fix that's gonna have to be addressed later on down the road? You know what I mean? I understand, and you know, I've followed what's been being said, and it's just my concern if they move the Gilmore kids, the Barrett Russell facility. But then it you know, I took a tour, I looked at the place. It's not a bad facility at all. People there are all very nice. But what if that program continues to grow? What then? Then more money to make more changes. I mean, there obviously is a problem, and this is one proposal. I'm sure there may have been other ones. Maybe there haven't been yet. Is this going to fix the problem, or is it a couple years from now going to have to do something all over again? You know, that's basically my one question. That's it. Thank you.
It is unusual to address hearing of visitors, but this is difficult times, and I do want all of you to know that we have certainly listened to what your concerns are, and you were right in coming certainly before us, speaking to your school committee members. I do appreciate all the hard work that has gone in on everybody's part, whether it's our school committee members. I know you've done your due diligence. I know you're listening to concerns. I know we've had two open houses. We've had meetings with parents. And we are taking everything into account, and we are trying to look at every population. And the gentleman that just spoke brings up a really interesting concern for our district. And I would like to say that we're a district that are able to truly prepare and have tax dollars and monies that are able to support a large growing district. And we're truly doing the very best we can. I'm pleased to say, Mayor, today was the first day that the school department actually got to meet with the facility master plan, and I thank you for that, because it's been a long time coming. I've been in the district a lot of years, and nobody has taken this step forward to truly have people come in and look at our district, look at areas that we will need to grow, or areas demographically that we move backwards, or how we have STEM for our children and make them competitive. Every one of our children, from the youngest, certainly to the oldest. So these are things that are all on the table. These are difficult times. And when we're looking at a $12 million deficit and possibly more, we're not only looking at ways of supporting all of our students and putting them in the best possible places that we can, but the one thing that I will assure you, and I have a couple of emails, I'm still backed up. I'm trying to answer all emails that come to me. There was an email recently about safety and security. Deputy Superintendent Thomas, Lieutenant Mills, we make sure our children are safe, whether they're at the Gilmore, the Barrett Russell, the Huntington, the Downey, the high school. You know, that is our number one priority in the district. So whatever happens with this, we will move forward and work with you. We're not going away. We're there to listen to any of the concerns that you have, and you can hold me accountable. You can hold your school committee accountable. I'm sure the mayor feels the same way. So we are available, again, to work with you, whatever your decision is moving forward.
You want to switch? We're all done with hearing of visitors. Do you want to switch back?
Or? Yeah, we can switch.
Okay.
What do you want to do?
You want me to run the meeting? I'll run the meeting.
Whatever you'd like to do.
apologize for the momentary timeout. And I apologize for being a few minutes late. I was tied up at my previous meeting. So let's get into the consent agenda, should be the next piece of business. So the consent agenda is a manner in which the school committee is able to conduct multiple transactions at once of relatively routine nature, help keep the meeting moving along and make us more efficient. However, before voting on a consent agenda, any member of the school committee may request that any individual item from the consent agenda be removed for individual discussion and deliberation. So at this time, I'll ask if any members of the committee would like to remove any items from tonight's consent agenda. Tom? Item B. Anyone else? Okay, so then we'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda absent item B. Motion made by Ms. Plant. We have a second. Mr. Gormley, all in favor? Opposed? The consent agenda passes.
Mr. Minicello, item B is the acceptance of the facilities subcommittee meeting report.
Okay, the facilities usage and planning subcommittee met on Tuesday, March 7th, and at that meeting, you know, the topic was the south side transitions, the considerations of reconfiguration, Goddard students moving to the Huntington, Huntington students moving to the Gilmore, Gilmore students moving to the Barrett-Russell, and some of the Barrett-Russell students, well, the Barrett-Russell students being integrated into neighborhood schools. At that meeting, we had testimony from Mr. Thomas, Ms. Saber, Lori Mason, and the committee was able to ask questions, get information, and as a result of that meeting, we took the matter under advisement and decided that we should have an open house at the Barrett-Russell to give parents an opportunity to view the site. We had two open houses, one this past Saturday and one last evening. That was basically the content of our meeting, and I would move to approve the minutes of that meeting.
Okay, so there is a motion on the floor looking for a second to approve the minutes of the Finance Subcommittee meeting as just presented by Mr. Minicello. Seconded by Mr. Gormley. All in favor? Okay. The minutes are accepted as presented by Mr. Minicello. Based upon the report, Mr. Minicello, is there a motion?
Well, I would make a motion to approve the superintendent's recommendation to make the south side transition as presented, Goddard to Huntington, Huntington to Gilmore, Gilmore to Barrett-Russell, and integrate the students at the Barrett-Russell to neighborhood kindergartens.
Okay. So first there's a motion on the floor. Is there a second? Seconded by Mrs. Sullivan. Discussion on the motion. Mr. Sullivan.
Yeah, just one thing on that facilities meeting. There was no vote taken at that time. I thought we'd take the vote prior, Tom, or before a motion is made.
Well, I mean, we took the matter under advisement. There doesn't have to be a vote, this, because ultimately this is a vote of the entire committee. So it's not as if one has to take place without it going to the committee.
Well, normal procedure is you have the motion in the facilities subcommittee, and nothing was done there. I can't see how you can put it up here now.
I think the subcommittee can make a recommendation, but it's not mandated to make a recommendation. It's been referred back to the full school committee for consideration. So I think it's being considered by the school committee without a specific recommendation from the subcommittee. The subcommittee chose to take the matter under advisement, according to the minutes, right?
Correct.
No, that's not right. The meeting was suspended and went into the regular meeting. There was no motion made by anybody.
Well, we
We suspended the meeting to go into a regular meeting, Tom.
We voted to have the matter under advisement.
No vote. There was no vote taken.
I
just assumed this was moved back to the facilities and a vote taken. There was no vote taken, Mr. Mayor.
I don't know that there's a vote required at the subcommittee level. We conduct all kinds of business. It doesn't necessarily flow through a subcommittee. I mean, I think the recommendations of the subcommittees are for the full committee to consider as part of their deliberation as to whatever item is in front of them. I think we're just about all the members of the school committee present at that subcommittee meeting?
I believe so.
Maybe all but Mrs. Sullivan? So I think 6 out of the 7 members were present, Tim, so it's not as if this were a subcommittee meeting held in an empty room and the other members of the committee weren't aware of what discussion took place. I think it was 6 out of 7 were here.
No, we're not driving it. That facility subcommittee is only 3 people.
Right.
Those 3 people were there and no vote was taken. The meeting was suspended. Now you're bringing up a motion here for the facility subcommittee.
But procedurally, I don't believe there's anything that prevents an item to go on the full agenda for the school committee to consider. I mean, you can certainly voice your opinion and vote how you want to vote.
Yeah, that's why I think that's why I'm allowing discussion on the motion right now so that all committee members can be heard on it before a vote is taken. Okay to move on, Tim? Or?
Yeah.
Okay. Ms. Plant.
In the minutes that we just approved, it was said that it was agreed that more discussion was needed on the facility moves and an open house at the Barrett-Russell will be planned at a convenient time for parents. Just to echo what Mr. Sullivan just said, yes, we did have the open houses, but we have not had more discussion on the matter.
I think that's what's taking
place. That's what
we're
doing
right now. That's why I asked for discussion on the motion, just specifically for that purpose, to make sure that there was full opportunity for discussion before a vote was taken.
I think I also misunderstood and thought that would mean that we would have more communications in subcommittee about it as well.
Okay. I still don't think there's a basis for us to not put it to a vote. If a majority feel that way, they'll vote no. I mean, I think the will of the committee as a whole will be heard. My feeling from this now being my 7th year on the school committee is that generally speaking, most subcommittee meetings are just 3 people in a room, usually by themselves, very little public there, very little coverage. And so it's quite often typical for that subcommittee, when it's only the 3 people, to make a recommendation to the committee as a whole, so that the committee as a whole, for the members who weren't at that subcommittee, have some sense as to what the opinion were of the members of that subcommittee. It's not binding on the full committee, and even members of the subcommittee can change their vote between the subcommittee vote and the full committee. I don't see that having a big impact here. 6 out of the 7 members were present at that meeting. I think everyone's fully informed on this. I think there have been public meetings and TV coverage and all kinds of things.
Just that it's clear there was no vote at the facilities meeting,
yeah,
and there's no recommendation.
Right. So I think it's on the record from Mr. Sullivan that there is no specific recommendation from the facilities subcommittee in regards to the item that's on the table right now. Ms. Sella?
I'd just like to make a statement that we've heard all your concerns from all the 3 schools considered, and I'm taking my vote on all students in the Brockton Public Schools. Okay, the Goddard to the Huntington, the kids will gain a better a building, better suited to their needs, and they'll be able to expand their program. The Huntington to the Gilmore school is better suited for the Huntington students because the Gilmore was built as an elementary school. It has a cafeteria with a stage and more restrooms. The Gilmore to the Barrett, the Barrett is already set up for our youngest learners. I've toured the school. It's a beautiful school. It's already got all the little toilets in there already, and everything is all set up. And the kindergarten students and the parents love the Barrett-Russell School.
Okay. Had hearing of visitors.
It is in remarkable condition that it has been brought up to that remarkable condition by our own people that have worked on it, our own journeyman,
craftsman,
forgot the name for a minute. We will certainly work with parents and get them what they want. So anybody that is not happy, the school committee is here to work with you and get you what you need for any school that you will move to. But we do have to take into consideration all students and how all students in the Brockton Public Schools will benefit from this plan.
Okay, any further discussion on the motion? Mr. Sullivan.
When we first started, it was spoke, number one, to put the kids first. Any vote taken, they would be put number one. And we all agreed. On this particular move, there's over 1,200 students being moved for the benefit of 54, and I don't think it's right. And I don't think it's putting the kids first by voting yes on that. And I'm gonna state right up front that I think this should be moved back to the facilities department. And if it goes forward for a vote, I am a no vote, not to move it.
Okay. I don't believe the motivation of the committee in considering this is to benefit 54 students at the expense of 1,200. I think what folks have to realize, if I can make a brief comment, is this is the beginning of a series of unbelievably difficult decisions over the next several months. We are looking at the worst budget forecast in my 7 years serving here on the school committee. Well, I won't take all the time now, but the governor's proposed local aid to education decimates a gateway city like Brockton. I think the superintendent is being conservative in projecting the deficit at $12 million. I was working on the budget today. I think the real number is closer to $15 to $16 million. If the governor's budget as is adopted. We're going to be working very hard and very closely with our legislative delegation. I've requested a meeting with the Senate president, Senator Rosenberg, to personally plead for the plight of the Brockton school system. The superintendent has already met with the Speaker of the House to make the same plea, along with a couple other gateway cities. But this probably saves this move, in, if enacted, about $1 million a year. That means it's a fraction of the cuts that are coming. The conversations are going to be around closing additional schools and laying off hundreds of employees, hundreds. So, I mean, those are the types of decisions that this committee is facing. And I think that, you know, having sat here for a while now, on both sides of this table, it's really tough. These committee members are going home, not sleeping, thinking about the ramifications of all these tough decisions that they've got to make over the next few months, and really right now trying to save a school system that's under financial siege from the state. And, you know, let's hope we can get some relief in the House and the Senate. But I think regardless of which way the vote goes, I don't think we should question the intent of the members of the committee. There can be honest differences of opinion between people who are all well-intentioned and all have the best interests of the kids at heart. So having said that, I'll just say, is there any more discussion on the motion? Seeing none, I'll ask for a vote. All in favor? I count four. Opposed? Three. The measure passes 4-3. Okay. We'll move on now to the report of the Superintendent of Schools on teaching and learning. Superintendent, it's your
meeting. Okay. I'd like to start, as we do each meeting, with inviting Somta, our student representative.
Let's take a 1 minute recess, folks, just while clearly a group of folks are leaving. Okay. I call the meeting of the school committee back to order. The floor belongs to the superintendent for her report on teaching and learning.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Again, I'd like to introduce our student representative from the high school, Somto, who will update us on things happening at Brockton High.
Parent-teacher conferences were last Thursday. They were well attended. ELA MCAS started today for sophomores. The spring choral concert is this evening at 7 o'clock. I believe it's 7 o'clock. The repertory chorus, concert choir, rock cappella, and harmonics will be performing. Spring sports tryouts have started, and auditions for the spring musical will begin tomorrow. Lastly, Brockton High would like to thank Save Our Sports for funding a remodel of the weight room.
Long overdue and a huge contribution to all of our students.
Thank you, as you said, to Save Our Sports. I know our own athletic director worked hours painting, putting together, bringing in training for our coaches. I was also there for just a few minutes on Friday and really look forward to seeing what is done with our student athletes as they prepare for their seasons.
Yes, it's a big upgrade. That was installed when I was a sophomore. And that was 20 years ago, believe it or not. back then, training methods were so much different. Things have really changed, and the way that we train our athletes has really changed. And I'm really happy to see our athletes get a chance to have a state-of-the-art facility, because when we go and play at Xaverian, I see a multi-million dollar weight room, and we are able to get pretty close to that for about $20,000. And a lot of it was donated, so. I'd like to thank Save Our Sports for supporting that.
Absolutely. huge addition for our students.
Thank you. And I'd like to move on. I want to start with our budget update. And just to update everyone out there, I led certainly at our finance meeting talking about advocacy. Aldo Petronio and I were in Revere yesterday along with six districts. There was Somerville, Everett, Brockton, Revere, Chelsea, and Lynn. And those are districts that are hardest hit by what we continue to talk about is our direct certification calculation. When I talk about we had everybody at the table, we actually had DESE there, Jeff Wolfson, the deputy commissioner. We had the AFT and the MTA. We had business managers. We had citizens for public schools. There was actually a charter representative. There was MASBO, many of the financial think tanks. There was the Secretary of Education, the Undersecretary, Mr. Tom Moreau, who we had an opportunity, Mr. Minicello, myself, Jay Condon, and Aldo Petronio had an opportunity to meet with last year. A lot of dialogue. It was a very quick 2.5-hour meeting where there was not only discussion to frame the problem and to look at solving the problem, but there were also what we are calling fixes. So we are truly moving ahead with the advocacy tomorrow at 10:30. Myself and two other superintendents are before the Gateway City Caucus, which is all of our legislative representatives, along with all of the Gateway Cities and their representatives. And the idea is, it isn't one individual district, it's all of us, coming together and making these decisions, as the mayor said, really trying to save, certainly, these seven school systems that are hardest hit, and there are a number of other districts. So I'll keep you updated on that. It's very much a fluid process right now as I speak. Also, an update on the Diversity Commission, our Diversity Task Force. We are moving forward again with our action plan, still in a draft form. But I will tell you, today I was able to view the video that was done for our Grow Your Own program. So the video was done with our TV studio here, teacher Lynn Tartaglia, and a number of staff members. And it is interviewing our own Brockton Public School teachers that actually went to Brockton High School. It shows the diversity. It talks about the value of going into teaching as a career. And if you remember, Mayor and I, you talking about our Grow Your Own program. We are looking for a place to unveil this. This is something we'd like to share with the community, with the BIC community, with our churches, with our community groups, and really start to talk this dialogue so it's happening in the homes, it's happening in the guidance offices, it's happening in our schools from even our younger students, coming into the Educate Rising program. So I was very pleased when I saw it, and again, just part of a much larger plan. I also want to congratulate in my school visits on Friday. I know everybody was celebrating St. Patrick's Day and wearing their green, but I had the opportunity to run out and go to the George School. I want to thank Principal Natalie Pohl and Michelle Zachary, our instructional resource specialist, who put together a fabulous day of really when you talk about project-based learning. And this was also in partnership with Massachusetts Clean Energy Center. We had a number of our partners there. We were talking about solar energy, wind energy, you know, projects, and kids forming hypotheses and actually testing in the classroom. So this was an excellent event, and I want to thank Michelle and certainly Natalie for hosting it in the school. It was exactly the kind of 21st century learning that we want to see happening in our school districts. I also want you to know that we have completed the process for our monitor site visits at both the Baker and the Arnone School. We are busy right now working with the Arnone School, looking at the evaluation that was done in coming in and viewing our classrooms, talking to staff, taking surveys, and talking about how we can quickly move instruction along to, again, to build on our instructional supports for students. So right now we are writing a grant. We are able to write for a $300,000 grant. We're working with the Brockton Education Association in partnership to put this grant forward, which would provide additional resources at this time for our known school, and we're very hopeful that we'll see something very similar, you know, for our Baker School. I also mentioned earlier today, it was great, Mayor, to be in that room with probably, I want to say today we had about 8 or 9 people, a number of principals. Principal Wolder was there, Principal Shauna Hearn. We're right in the middle of course, our MCAS testing, so it was difficult to pull people out, but today was the first facility master plan kind of think tank. And there were questions posed about what we want our district to look like, how we would involve the community in coming up with this plan. And again, this is part of a much larger plan. Interesting enough, on Monday, I did again run into Jack McCarthy from the Mass mm-hmm. School Building Assistance. And they're very much looking to partner with us as a city. They're interested in looking at our high school, in talking about what we really do, you know, with our footprint. But today was the beginning. I believe we have 2 other meetings coming up. And I know, Mayor, they're also looking at the facility, the city facilities also.
Right. This is a facilities master plan of all city facilities. Clearly, the majority of those buildings are school buildings.
Okay, and I want to move on to, we have awards at 12 schools from the EOS Foundation for what they're calling Healthy Breakfast. So this is something, again, that we started a number of years ago with one school in the district that served the so-called breakfast in the classroom. They're also able to look at the grab and go that we have at the Ashfield School, and 12 of our schools have been awarded $500. There is a big ceremony at the State House where they honor those districts that are making a difference. One of the criteria is for 2 months running, 80% participation of our students in our schools. So the schools are the Angelo, the Arnone, Ashfield Middle, Baker, Barrett, Brookfield, Davis, Downey, George, Hancock, Huntington, and Raymond. So a congratulations to those schools. And again, we continue to provide breakfast in the classroom and meet the mandates of what we're calling the Breakfast Challenge. And lastly, I want to mention I had a busy Saturday. I know, Mayor, you and I were kind of in and out of a number of events. And 2 of the events that I want to mention is there was an award given by the Daughters of the American Revolution. I will tell you that when this was in the Abington Public Library, a beautiful facility, and they meet, and what they do is they honor somebody. And the person that they honored is Miss Sylvia Donaldson. And this is a woman that was a principal in the Brockton Public Schools in the 20s. She was a woman certainly before her time. She was a teacher, a principal in the district. At 73 years old, she became a member of the state legislature, our House of Representatives. And although it was for one day, she was Speaker of the House for one day, and probably, I'm going to guess, the first woman to take that gavel and become Speaker of the House. So we were given a plaque. We will hang it proudly. And I just want everybody to see. The thing that I was disappointed, and I don't know other women out there, so we all think about it's exciting to be part of an organization. But one of the things that I thought was really interesting is to be part of the American Daughters of the American Revolution, you actually have to have pedigree. You know, of somebody that fought in the revolution. And I went home and asked my mom, and of course, my mom's family came from Italy. So she assured me that we were not part, and this was and this was not going to be an organization I could belong to. They were fabulous. They have good citizen awards for students. There were a number of students receiving this on the same day. So again, very proud to accept this, and I want to thank the Daughters of the American Revolution for supporting our school district and our students. Every year they give, I believe, two scholarships to our JROTC students. And I know, Mayor, you were also at the community school basketball. I was able to go there. I kind of got there at the end of the evening. But again, it was a long season. It's great when I go there and see the parents and the grandparents and supporting their kids in the finals in a very healthy environment, volunteer coaches. It is exactly what makes our city great. And I want to thank George Lewis for overseeing the program, all of our housemasters, as we call them there, that oversee the different gyms during the basketball season. To, again, our volunteer coaches, to the parents, to the players. It was a lot of fun, you know, had by all.
It was good. The highlight for me was that at halftime of the coaches' game, they DJ Henry Dream Foundation presents an award for the Player of the Year, and it's really a quite an honor to be selected to receive it, and the DJ Dream Fund provides a lot of scholarships for a lot of the kids that get to play that wouldn't financially be able to pay. And I just want to mention, you know, Dan and Angela Henry and all the great work they do behind the scenes, and so it was a pleasure for me to be there for the presentation of that award.
And you know, Mayor, I always talk about, you know, being in community schools at the time, and again, it was a year after their son was killed and they had started the fund, and they truly came knocking at the door of community schools, and not many people do that, knock on your door and say, you know, we have $1,000 at the time and would like to give it to kids to make sure they have access to programs. They've certainly secured, you know, many more thousands of dollars beyond that, lots of volunteers, kids from all over, not just Brockton, but Brockton. It has been a great partnership, and again, I agree with you. I want to thank them for everything they do to make sure our kids have access to many programs, not just sports programs. And I want to finish up by mentioning to parents, we have started our MCAS testing. Many of our schools, our grade 8 throughout the district, will be doing their online testing. So this preparation going out, make sure again the kids are getting, you know, certainly sleep, that they're well prepared. They've worked hard this year, and this is when it's important, you know, for parents to motivate them. You know, we're excited for them to be able to take this test. Our students fare very well. You know, we just mentioned the breakfast. You know, either send your kids with breakfast, or we do provide breakfast in the classroom throughout our district, or certainly breakfast opportunities. So moving forward, we'll have now a couple of months of testing. And that's my report for this evening.
Okay, we're going to try to move along to wrap this up so that everyone can make it to the concert. Unfinished business. We have the 2017-2018 academic calendar, and we are looking for action on approval of the school calendar for the upcoming 2017-2018 school year. Everyone's got a copy of it in their package. It's been presented at a previous meeting. So is there any discussion, or Ms. Plant?
In past years, we have added on the dates of the MCAS testing. I know we haven't done that maybe in a couple of years. Is that something you'd consider doing? I think it's good for the parents to have that information on the calendar.
Right, we can certainly do it at this point in a separate calendar. I'm not sure that the dates are actually confirmed yet. I don't think I've seen the dates for next year yet.
Okay.
So we can certainly take a look. If the dates come in, we will get them on the calendar. But at this point here, we wanted to get it set as far as the dates off. I mean, those are obviously school days. You're just talking about notification to parents.
She's right. It used to be on the large district calendar.
Yeah.
Oh, for the beginning of the year.
Yeah, it used to be right on here.
Yes.
Yeah,
I just haven't seen them yet.
Okay.
Okay. I think it works out well when parents know that at the beginning of the year if they're scheduling to take time off from school and don't run into that. Thank you.
Good.
So you're okay with that? If they get the dates in time, they'll be on the printed version that goes out to the parents. Mr. Sullivan.
I'd like to make a motion.
We're listening.
A motion to approve the 2017-2018 academic calendar and supplement calendar as printed.
Okay. Motion by Mr. Sullivan, seconded by Mr. D'Agostino. All in favor? Opposed? Passes unanimously. All right. And I guess, are we doing this finance subcommittee report? Okay.
Finance subcommittee met on March 16th, 2017, over at the Arnone School. Discussed at the meeting was the state of the budget. There were several motions that the committee made that evening. Motion to close the FY17 school budget was one. Motion to approve a hiring freeze with the superintendent's discretion effective immediately. There was a motion to approve a retirement incentive with respect to BEA members for 25,000, admin assistants 20,000, custodians 20,000, MTAs 15,000, paraprofessionals 14,000, and non-union people would be negotiated. We then also discussed issues with respect to saving cost savings and the overall budget implications with regard to the south side transition, which was obviously discussed this evening. The superintendent talked to us about the budget implications with respect to the different areas in her pie chart that showed, you know, where funding goes. Obviously, the largest is personnel, and then there were, you know, different subcategories. We also discussed the consequences of not making changes to the structure of the Brockton public schools, and how that basically would have negative implications with regard to actual teaching positions and staff members with regard to potential layoffs for the upcoming year. So that, in essence, was the minutes of the finance subcommittee report. So I would make a motion to approve those minutes.
Okay. Motion to accept the report made, seconded by Mr. Sullivan. All in favor? Opposed?
And then I guess
report is approved.
I guess we need to just ratify the motions that were made that evening. Motion to close the FY17 budget. Motion to approve the hiring freeze with superintendent's discretion. Motion to approve the retirement incentives as I previously listed. Ms. Alves can certainly fill in the details. And then a motion to take any additional action she deemed appropriate.
So unless there's any objection by a member of the committee, why don't we just consider those all as one block for one vote? No objections? Okay. We'll take a motion on approving all of those motions as one block. Motion made by Mr. Minicello, seconded by Mr. Sullivan. All in favor? Opposed? That's accepted. We have 1 minute remaining. Anyone new business? Mr. Sullivan.
There was a bid review meeting held this week, and there was one item brought up, which isn't here. It was a motion to approve the lease for the facilities building. On Foster Street.
Okay.
It was approved unanimous. Okay. I guess we have to bring it up to the floor tonight.
Does that have to come back to the full committee or no? Is it already done? No?
Is that bid review?
Yes.
Yeah, it was bid review.
Correct.
The meeting was this week.
That's what I think. Okay. So just to clarify, Mr. Sullivan, it's scheduled to be on the agenda for the meeting of the 4th.
Okay.
For approval of the lease by the full committee. Yeah, right. This meeting was already posted by before you took that action.
I didn't know
that. Yep. But that's okay. We'll get it at the next meeting. Anyone else?
One quick note. We've got a committee got a thank you note from Donna Midgale for a gift that we that I picked up on behalf of the committee, and we gave her, and she's very thankful for it. And
okay.
She
nice.
Sends her best to all of us and her appreciation. So.
All right, great. Judy.
Also, if I remember, our former Ward 3, right? School committee, Alicia Clark Wilson, had a baby on 3/15. Her name is Ainsley Rose Wilson.
She's very busy.
Future school committee member. Yeah. Anyone else on the new business?
I'll be quick, but I wanted to, I know we're pressed for time, but since there is Principal O'Brien and members of her team in the room tonight, I wanted to bring up, you know, one of the struggles that they've had at the Huntington School is getting people to be able to come and be a part of the PTO and that traditional 7 p.m. type of meeting time that has never really worked very well. And I won't get into too much details because of timing, but they've really thought outside of the box and gotten a lot more creative about it. They're doing things in the morning, they're doing things midday, and it's really made a difference with providing those opportunities for parents to get involved. And I just wanted to recognize her and her team for, you know, looking at that and deciding, hey, we've got to do something different. And I think from what I've seen so far, you're getting that participation way more than you have in a long time. So.
Ryan?
No, it's bagels and bananas with the principal.
I did not come up with the name, like that on the team.
I think it's great.
And they came up with the idea. However,
yeah. Well, we all missed a great performance this Friday, by the way, by Miss O'Brien at that meeting, but.
Okay. Anyone else on a new business? Okay, how about a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion made, seconded. All in favor? Meeting adjourned.